I rarely ever do something like this, and I honestly don't think I've ever done it. I don't remember ever doing it, making an entire episode about somebody else's work. But I'm gonna do just that. I used to listen to Art Bell way back, when I was a young lad, when I was a kid, basically. I still listen to Art Bell. I like listening to it. It's the same thing as like listening to music that you heard as a kid and you still like. There are some real guests who know what they're talking about on that show. And this is one of those shows. I'm going to play you a show from 1995. 1995, a guest was on Art Bell talking about harp and what harp really is and what it is capable of doing. And it is everything that I'm talking about in 2023, 28, 29 years later. But there are some things that I would like to say before I play this interview. One, it's Nick Begich. And he seems very straightforward in this interview. But recently I've heard that Begich is backing up the mental health scam. Now, I don't know if this is because he hasn't done his research or if he's owned and operated or if he's just ignorant in that area. But either way, he's very open in this interview, and that's important to note. Also, this show speaks about frequencies being transduced into mechanical sound. And this was back in 1995. This is really important. They also briefly speak about polluting the body with chemicals or agents and then manipulating those agents with frequencies, which is something that I've been speaking about. And people said it was madness when I started speaking about it. And they're talking about this back in 1995, just briefly, but they speak about it. Another thing that they speak about is the fact that this tech went wireless long, long ago. Yet we still see shows about wired contraptions like Persinger's God Helmet. And we're talking apparatuses that bounce a billion watts off the ionosphere, a gigawatt of power. That's insane. And more now. We're talking about gigawatts and gigawatts to cover the entire Earth, through Earth. It also speaks about ELF locking onto people's brains. I took notes here because there's things that I want to say before I play it. At one point, they mentioned a white noise generator that will work as a blocker for this. I do not believe that will work these days, for one. I think the tech has advanced way further, and I've experimented with white noise, and I do not see that happening. So go ahead and experiment with it if you want, but I don't believe this has an effect now. And you have to remember that this was 1995. It was, 28, 29, almost 30 years ago. So it's a long time, but it may be something that you might want to experiment with while lying in bed. You can't walk around covered in wires in a white noise machine. You just can't do it. And I also believe fully that they've solved the issue of every single human being affected by this with the use of sensitizers. That way, the sensitized people are affected by it, and those who aren't sensitized aren't. I mean, this solves a huge problem for them. And there is more than enough evidence proving that these sensitizers are at work. They also talk about EMPs and computers being affected by this. Now, this is a true story. Not that many years ago, a few years ago, we were in my house and there was a large boom that sounded like it came from underneath the house. The problem is there's nothing underneath the house, nothing you can get to. And when this boom went off, the lights were not affected. The electricity was not affected. The only thing that shut off was my computer. And at that point, I went to reboot the computer and it would not boot up. And it said, cannot load Windows, that a recent hardware or software change may have caused this. So that was really, really strange to have happen. What I ended up having to do is get another hard drive, load Windows onto that, and then run that drive as a slave drive to get the information off of it. But I was able to retrieve the information eventually. But very strange. They also speak about this technology dissolving tires and melting engines. So that is something to note. And then people started calling in and talking about anomalies that happened to them back when you could actually talk about these anomalies happening. Pilots and other kinds of people who would now lose their license if they talked about this. Quote, the science is real, the project is real, and this was 1995. But if there's anything else that I remember, I'll write it down in the comments, but there were some things that I wanted to say for sure before I played this, and now I'm going to leave you with this interview, and it talks about everything that I talk about on this channel, and it was back in 1995. So thanks for watching, and here we go.
Welcome to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. the night featuring Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995.
From the high desert in the great American Southwest. Guess what, everybody? It's Friday night, Saturday morning, and it's going to be a very eclectic kind of show this morning. The kind so many of you seem to enjoy. It will be repeated Sunday night, Monday morning. So if you don't get it all tonight, you'll get a chance to get it then. So it's going to get a lot of exposure, and, well, it should. My guest coming up is Dr. Nick Begich, an author. He's talking about the HAARP Project in Alaska, and he's going to be up shortly. So we continue to get these strange, strange reports of magnetic deviation. Could it have anything to do with HAARP? So let's go to Alaska and talk to Dr. Begich. Dr. Begich.
Hello, how are you this evening?
Very well, thank you. Thank you for being patient through all that. I take it that you may know of Standeo in one way or another.
Yeah, I think I've read, I've read a number of his articles, so I am a bit familiar with his work.
Where are you in Alaska, by the way?
I'm in Anchorage.
Anchorage, all right. We had you on one time, or in the sense that Linda did an interview with you, Linda Howe,
right,
on a Dreamland program about HAARP. So I guess we need to begin at the beginning, because there's a big audience here who doesn't get Dreamland. They don't know what HAARP is. I barely know what HAARP is. What is HAARP?
Okay, I'm going to kind of characterize it in two different ways. First, let's talk about what the military says it is, and let's talk about then what our research indicates that it is, and where we feel pretty confident the project is really headed. Project HAARP, the HAARP is an acronym for High Frequency Active Auroral Research Project, which is a mouthful in and of itself. But it really is kind of a misnomer at the same time. I mean, it's really not so much about the aurora as it is the very upper portion of the layering of the atmosphere, if you will, to, in simple terms, the ionosphere, which is between 50 miles and 620 miles above the Earth's surface. And this is the area in which, the lower portion in which, at least, is where the aurora takes place. And the upper portions are an ionized area where a number of varying effects occur. And it's essentially the shield around the Earth that protects us from incoming cosmic radiations, X-rays.
All right, and my audience ought to know, I'm a ham radio operator, doctor, and it is that which allows people at this time of night to hear KENI radio hundreds of miles there in Anchorage, away from Anchorage, as the ionosphere, I believe, thickens, check me if I'm wrong, during the nighttime hours. These signals and certain frequencies at short wave are then able to, in effect, bounce off the ionosphere and come back to Earth. That's how AM radio stations are able to be heard at a very long distance at night. Basically correct?
Yeah, basically that's correct. And what essentially the military has been doing here in Alaska is experimenting with ways of creating sort of artificial effects in the ionosphere. And the things that they pretty openly talk about, in fact, they very openly talk about, first of all, if people remember a number of years ago in Wisconsin, they were putting in really long antennas on the ground running miles and miles, which were to generate an extremely low frequency for communicating with submarines.
Right.
What they're doing now with the ionospheric research is, by modulating the ionosphere, they can actually create that extremely low frequency, making the ionosphere essentially converting it from DC to AC. So what it in fact does...
Wait a minute. Slow up. You're even starting to lose me. I understand the process of modulation. That is to attach, as I have always understood it, intelligence to a carrier.
Right.
The process.
What they're using is a radio frequency transmitter in Alaska. It's a very high frequency transmitter, radio frequency transmitter, but it generates a very large amount of energy. What it in a sense does, what they in fact call them, the military calls them ionospheric heaters, because they generate so much power. But what they do is on the Earth, they convert electricity to radio frequency, and then
right,
through an antenna array,
I've seen photographs of it, by the way. It is what kind of space? All these dipoles they have set up on the ground. I've seen the photographs. They're incredible. How many of them are there? How much space does this encompass?
It's probably on the order of 20 acres right now, but the actual site itself that it's positioned on is a 5,000-acre site. And it's designed to be modular and added to, periodically. In fact, the first two phases of the project were originally contracted to a company, Arco Power Technologies. And the first phase is complete and is operating in a test mode. And what these antenna arrays do, essentially, is they take the electricity, convert it to radio frequency, and then they send that up to the ionosphere. And the way you can visualize this, and this is a very unique feature in this particular ionospheric heater, when all of the other heaters operating in the world, and there are several, there's some in the Soviet Union, there's one in Norway, they're sort of scattered about. But when you look at them, the old technologies, if you visualize a cone with the narrow portion of the cone on the Earth and the wide portion at the ionosphere with the energy getting less and less dense as it goes higher and higher.
Of course.
That's the old technology.
Like a shotgun blast.
Right, exactly. Just keep spreading out, and the impact gets less and less the further away from the source it gets.
Understood.
What this new technology has developed is a way to focus the energy so that it starts out with the wide angle at the base, which is this reason for this large antenna array, and it focuses the energy into a narrow beam. So what's delivered at the ionosphere is
really
many, many, many times more powerful than what previously could be done with old technology.
At about what frequency are they doing this, do you know?
I have it in the specs, but it's a broad range that they've been actually licensed. But the design gives them essentially the complete radio frequency ranges all the way up into microwave ranges, but they are only authorized in certain bands. And I don't have those right in front of me where I can give those to you.
Okay.
But essentially what's going to occur and what they're doing now is they're focusing that energy up. They're creating a blast of energy in the ionosphere to create, first of all, by pulsing it or modulating it, mm-hmm. in a certain way, they create this ELF for the purpose of communicating with submarines. And since the very beginning, they've acknowledged that's one of the applications that the DOD, Department of Defense, sees in this particular technology. The other application that they're currently have in the federal budget for 1996 is what's called Earth Penetrating Tomography. And to put that in simple terms, this is where they're going to bounce a signal. They're going to create a plasma mirror, is what they call it. By sending the energy up into the ionosphere, they're going to create sort of an artificial lens. And then from another transmitter located in Alaska near Fairbanks called High Pass, they're going to bounce a signal off of that man-made plasma lens.
Wow.
And it's going to come back down to the Earth at a coherent, extremely low frequency. It's going to be running in the 1 to 30 hertz range. And with instruments placed on the ground or traversing the ground and slow moving aircraft, they're able to look, literally look down into the Earth several kilometers. And what the intention is, and what this is funded under the United States budget, is under non-proliferation, counter-proliferation.
All right, I want you to hold it right there. I've got a million questions. We're at the bottom of the hour. Relax. We'll be right back to you and get into this more deeply. Dr. Nick Begich is my guest, co-author of Angels Don't Play This Harp. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995. Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995.
Now listen, this is kind of technical stuff, but don't let that worry you. We'll keep Dr. Begich grounded, and I'll try and help as much as I can. Angels don't play this harp. It's important. It's about the HARP project in Alaska. And it may not be what you think it is or what they're trying to tell us it is. One thing's for sure, it's fascinating. And we'll talk more about it in just a moment. You're back on the air, Doctor.
Okay, I'm going to try and keep it non-technical, so those technophiles out there, don't be offended, but I want to
make sure
everyone really understands what we're talking
about. Here's what will help them understand, Doctor. Let's explain about the spectrum. Where does the spectrum begin? In other words, beginning with audio, you know, that the sound of our voice, and going up.
Okay, let me get a quick reference out.
Well,
in other words, background is
okay. Well, I can help. Our voice is one part of the spectrum. There are frequencies lower than even that. But you think about it this way: our voice is one spectrum. Where sound ends, radio begins. In other words, at one hertz, radio begins, and it goes all the way up and then into the short wave. The broadcast band, the AM broadcast band, then short wave, what's called short wave. Then it goes up into the microwave region, and then eventually it goes into light. And that is the spectrum. Now, the area that you're talking about, HARP, you're saying is dealing with frequencies between 1 and 30 hertz. That's very low.
As far as the as for this particular earth-penetrating tomography application, that is correct.
Well, that's very low, and that's also very interesting because I've heard, Doctor, that these are frequencies that affect our biological beings.
That's correct, and that's what we're going to get into next because I think that's really an important area that people really, really don't really recognize what can happen here. And in our research and when we put the book together, we focused a great deal on the biological effects, the physiological effects of ELF, extremely low frequency.
Right.
And what our research showed and what we found was a number of very compelling documents. We found some documents from the Air Force and International Red Cross. The ones from the Air Force deal with the development of radio frequency weapons that can be pulsed at a low frequency like what we're talking about here for use in debilitating mental functions of troops over a battlefield area.
Oh, boy.
And the document that we found specifically was Low-Intensity Conflict in Modern Technology, and it was put together by Maxwell Air Force Base in 1986. And the particular sections that we were concerned about indicate very strongly that these were where the government was in the 80s, in the middle 80s and early 80s, developing these kind of weapon systems. And when you think about the discussions in the press in recent years about microwave weapons and non-lethal weapons, they kind of skirt the microwave and they skirt the radio frequencies, although they're mentioned occasionally. In fact, we reference symbols in the text, the New York Times articles, that talk about those weapons on a very quick and cursory basis.
Let me try and understand. What can you describe what the physiological effects or what we know about the physiological effects of very low-frequency, high-intensity RF. How does it affect the human being?
Okay, well, let's talk about mental function primarily.
All right.
And we can start with research that goes back to the 60s. There was a gentleman by the name of J.F. Gordon MacDonald, who was a science advisor to Lyndon Johnson, and he was a geophysicist at UCLA. And what he asserted in 1969 was that by modulating the ionosphere at a very low frequency, you could, in fact, debilitate human beings' mental function. In other words, create disturbances in mental functions, causing mood swings over very large areas. Now, this is as early as 1969. Then in 1970, Zbigniew Brzezinski, who was National Security Advisor to Jimmy Carter, wrote a book. And that book we referenced as well, and it was called Between Two Ages. And in that book, he lays out, again, this technology that was coming. But at the time, there was not a way to get enough energy up to the ionosphere to create that effect. what HARP is and what it's capable of is getting that kind of energy density to the ionosphere and modulating it to create those kind of effects over a very broad area.
Okay, my next question may be one you cannot answer. Are they able, do you know, to direct the, you say over a very broad area, they bounce this wide then narrow beam at the ionosphere, off the ionosphere, and it comes back to Earth. Are they able to direct where it comes back?
Yes, within certain perimeters. The way they do that is the ionospheric or the plasma mirror that they create with that blast.
Yes.
The way the patents read, and see, we found the 12 patents associated with this specific project, and those we describe very carefully in the book, and we break out exactly what they mean. But with that mirror that they create, they have the ability to move it and focus it and direct it so that pulsed energy coming off of it actually goes directionally the way they want it to go.
Oh, boy. So in other words, if we were in a battle, take situation, for example, in Iraq.
Right.
They might be able to actually focus low-frequency energy down on a battlefield full of hundreds of thousands of the enemy and create mental confusion, perhaps mood swings, as you pointed out. In other words, completely, mentally demoralize the enemy.
And doesn't that sound like what happened there? I mean, the speculation that we've heard, and it is speculation, that in fact they were testing these kinds of weapon systems in the Gulf War. And there's, in all likelihood, when you think back on the, you know, on the footage that was coming out of there, and I mean, they didn't shoot back much. I mean, we had situations there where people basically were confused and over large areas.
But yeah, only one little thing, though, Doctor. There's a big controversy right now about a lot of our troops that are coming back.
That's right.
With debilitating mental dysfunctional diseases and physiological diseases, and nobody quite can figure out what the hell it is.
Right. And we explore the physiological effects of when you take low frequencies or specific frequencies that will resonate with chemicals that are already in the body, that may be in the body in amounts that are considered non-toxic or non-lethal.
Yes, sir.
But if you hit the resonating frequency of those chemicals, you can in fact create a toxic environment that becomes unexplainable because the actual levels of the chemicals aren't there, and yet you've sort of souped them up, you've amped them up in a way, and then you've created a physiological response or a chemical reaction, and then when you take the radiation away, you know, things drop back to normal, but yet you still have this chemical reaction that's already taken place. So, you know, that speculation is there. And what we do in the book is we document, you know, scientists that have developed that technology. We show where the Navy has developed technologies along these lines. We show where a specific researcher, Jose Delgado, working at Yale University for a number of years, in fact, almost a couple of decades, developed a way using radio frequency, first with implants and later wirelessly, creating mood swings in animals and humans where they would go from basically almost a sleep state to high anxiety and agitation and back and forth and back and forth, like switching on a light switch.
You know, this is going to surprise you, but over the past several days, Doctor, I've been getting faxes. We have this whole magnetic anomaly, brouhaha. Do you listen up there? Do you get to listen in Alaska?
Right, and I have picked up some of that same data. And you know, the issues come to me, and people have asked, you know, could this be HARP? And the answer is, yeah, it could be, you know, but that's against speculative.
All right. But I wanted to add to that. On top of the night, we had all this magnetic anomaly baloney going on. I started getting faxes from people. You may have even heard me read one from people who said, you know, it's a funny thing. We were in this wonderful mood and the other day, and on the very day the magnetic business occurred, and all of a sudden, a lighthearted, happy mood turned into a depressed, for no reason, and there was a whole group, a depressed, unusual, strange mood just like that.
Yeah, and that can happen. But what it requires in order to happen is it requires an ELF in the low range, in the 1 to 30 hertz range, is what the research shows. And we point to that research in the text. The text has 357 footnoted sources. So as people roll through, they can actually go to those source documents and see for themselves. But when you're operating in that low frequency range, if it's delivered in the right waveform at the right frequency, you can create these effects. Now let's talk about what the military said when we interviewed them about the earth-penetrating tomography application.
In other words, looking for underground tunnels and bunkers and stuff.
Right. Mm-hmm. And it will, and they can do that. But they also are operating in that 1 to 30 hertz range is what they acknowledge. And they said, but you know, it's no problem because we're operating when the energy comes back to Earth, it's essentially the same as what otherwise might naturally occur in the Earth. The only difference is that it's coherent or it's rhythmic. But that's exactly the condition you need
yes.
to create these debilitating effects. In fact, Jose Delgado at Yale showed that you only needed energy levels at 1/50th, 1/50 of the Earth's naturally occurring energy strength, if you will.
Uh-huh.
The only difference is it had to be coherent or
pulsed.
Rhythmic.
Modulated, pulsed.
That's right. And so here's what we have. We have HARP that's able to be directed over a very large area, create conditions 50 times more powerful than what's necessary, and yet they're not talking about this. There's no biological scientists on the front end of this project, at least, that are attached to this project. I mean, we don't know what's behind the scenes, but we certainly have a pretty good idea. The way the research unfolded and what we were able to find in the government records were, I mean, they're scary. But at the same time, what we tried to do with this text is deliver the information so people would know and could react to it in a logical and sequenced, you know, pace. And we use a lot of metaphor. I mean, we take a complex idea and we keep breaking it down so that no matter who reads this text, you'll understand it. And that was the key, because it's not like an oil spill that you can go wrap your hands around and feel badly about. It's radio frequency
yes.
energy. You can't
All right.
see it.
Doctor, you said there were other ionospheric heaters about the world. I'm a ham radio operator, and for years we suffered with something that we called the woodpecker.
Right.
Which was ostensibly an over-the-horizon radar attempt by the Russians.
Let's talk about that, because
right.
that's one of the additional applications that HARP has. In fact, the site that it's sitting on is the old site for the backscatter over-the-horizon radar that the military was putting together.
Uh-huh.
And they abandoned it, theoretically, after the Cold War, and then built this. And in fact, one of the patents is for that very specific application. The only difference is this technology is even better, because the backscatter, the way it worked is once things got close in, you lost them on the screen.
That's right.
This from the ionosphere, from the area in which, you know, satellites are just about operating in, all the way down to ground level, including cruise missiles coming in, it can detect them without distortion from distance over the horizon all the way in to right on the transmitter site if need be. The difference is, one of the other applications of this is it creates an energy field around each of those incoming objects that produces a real unique signature or identifying characteristic. And those characteristics can then determine which objects might be carrying, for instance, nuclear payloads, or which objects are dummies. But again, they're doing it in a way where the energy is coming back and, in fact, impacting the entire population. So it's one of those applications that is within the documents. One of the other applications within the patents is a power beaming technology, which goes right back to some of the ideas of Nikola Tesla in the early 1900s.
Is this technology from Tesla?
It's fun. You know, it is. And here's how it chases back. When I first researched this subject, it wasn't my area, but it kind of dropped in my lap. And
sure.
It was an important enough area for me to drop my work for a year and my other research and just follow this project. And what we found first was these original patents by Bernard Eastland, who was hired by ARCO, Atlantic Richfield Company, which is one of the biggest oil companies in the world.
Oh, yes.
And he was hired to find a way to burn natural gas on the North Slope. And when he developed this series of patents for this focused ionospheric heater, and that's how he got the patent, was that very little bitty distinguishing characteristic, but was so profound, was being able to focus that energy. On that basis, he was granted the patent, and which was assigned immediately to ARCO.
Can you tell us how that occurs? In other words, normally, from a dipole radiator, As you pointed out earlier, the radiation starts with a narrow beam, and as it goes out, further it goes out, it spreads out. How do you technically reverse that process?
What they're doing is they're firing them in series, which is creating a cyclotron resonance. And so if you think about it, it's sort of corkscrewing it up as it's focusing it. But it's a firing sequence that's unique to this heater. And the way they sequenced it, it created this focused beam, but it required a larger array and the ability to fire in a certain sequence to create that effect. And we had some radio engineers take a look at all of these patents and tell us, will this work? How will this work? And then we pulled the original patent file, which actually diagrammed this effect that I'm describing. But in simple terms, it was the firing sequence with the antennas and the particular antenna configuration and design that created this effect. One of the other things that we found in those patents, and this is what really triggered my interest from the very beginning, is there were these references to two New York Times articles, one from 1915 and one from 1940. And I thought, you know, what the heck is a New York Times article referenced in a patent that's from the 1980s, going back that far? And the first thing that jumped in my mind is it's got to be Tesla. And when I pulled those New York Times articles, that's exactly what it was. And it was about his weapon system that people, you know, still talk about and remember, which was this system that would melt engines at distance and would create all of these really highly unusual effects. And people equated it with particle beams and all different kinds of things. But that was the stimulus for Bernard Eastland's genius as he applied it to this particular technology.
Do you think what they called a beam weapon then was focused RF?
I think probably so. It's just that, you know, when you look back at Tesla patents and the terminology used, I mean, everything was, you know, evolving then, so the words just are confusing, you know. I think maybe they're better than they are now because they sort of talked more about the effect, but I think that's probably what was going on there. But the fact is, it was the stimulus for Bernard Eastland to create this particular patent and then two others that went with it. And then coming off of that, there were other scientists surrounding this project, and they then took Bernard Eastland's ideas and using a much smaller antenna design, one on more of the order of what HARP currently is, and they developed these over-the-horizon radar effects,
right,
power beaming technologies. In fact, the Earth systems that were being experimented by Raytheon Corporation in the 60s, the same scientist that was doing the work then is now sitting at the University of Fairbanks on a project called SABRE.
Okay, when you talk about power beaming, you're talking about sending actual usable amounts of electrical energy in a beam.
That's right. And what they visualize here is there's three patents. One is for the beaming system, one is for the reflector, and one is for a receiving antenna. And they look at it in a couple of different ways. One is suspending platforms in space where they can run these long-term missions by sending energy up. And the biggest handicap has always been being able to get enough energy up because of that problem with the further you go, the less energy gets delivered at a point.
But all right. At that point, we have got to stop our energy and turn it over to the news. So
Premier Radio Networks presents Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight's program originally aired December 1st, 1995.
For years, people have talked about mind control. This may be the real thing. We'll update you on what HARP is and what it might be doing in just a moment. All right, I think that this is a wise thing to do. I know a lot of you are joining us, San Francisco and others, at this hour. So let us retrench. If you would like to send in a fax with a question for Dr. Bigich, who is in Alaska, which, by the way, is where the HARP project is located, my fax number is area code 702-727-8499. 702-727-8499. And it makes sense to begin this way. Hi, Art. I missed the first half hour or so of your show. Could you please tell us again, please, Doctor, what HARP stands for?
Okay, it stands for the High Frequency Active Auroral Research Project. And what it really amounts to is HARP is a very large radio frequency transmitter that sends an effective radiated power to the ionosphere, which is that upper portion between 50 and 650 miles, say, above the Earth's surface. It sends up to 1 billion watts of effective radiated power.
That's
1 gigawatt.
A billion watts?
That's correct. That's the effective radiated power.
Watts.
Now, the input power is less than that, but there's a factor of what they call antenna gain.
Gain, sure.
So what you get, according to the government record, is 1,000 times antenna gain. So a megawatt in is a gigawatt out. That's at phase one. That's where this first phase is headed. Right now it's running at about a third of that power, headed for a gigawatt within the next 12 months or so.
All right, question. We had all these reports of magnetic anomalies, tons and tons of them. It went on for the whole night. Could the HARP project cause such an anomaly?
You know, that I've heard the same speculation, and it's possible. It would take some, you know, at this power level, it would take probably a number of unique circumstances. Things would already have to be at a threshold. But let's talk about that, because this is where the root of our concern really lies with HARP. And if you look back historically, when you're talking magnetic anomalies,
yes, sir.
There's been three magnetic shifts. In the last, say, 80,000 years, you know, at one point, the magnetic north was sitting somewhere in the Yukon about 80,000 years ago.
Right.
It shifted out to just off the coast of Norway, and then 50,000 years ago, it shifted to the Hudson Bay area, and then 15,000 years ago, approximately, it shifted to its current location.
How
what all caused that is, you know, subject to some speculation.
Okay, I was going to ask you, does that mean, Doctor, in your opinion, best guess, that magma is moving under the Earth, or does it mean an iron core, latest theory, is somehow shifting, or what do you think might be going on to shift the magnetic poles? How can it happen?
It could be both of those factors, combination of those factors, as well as there's been some speculation that a lining up of planetary bodies creates a resonance effect in terms of gravity waves.
Yes.
I mean, there's lots of different speculation, but the fact is, it does happen. Now, the question becomes, when you look around the planet today, everyone knows the planet is releasing a lot of energy right now in the
yes.
form of earthquakes. Weather patterns are disruptive. It's not just the United States. It's
yes.
all over the planet.
Yes, correct.
And it's increasing. I mean,
yes.
when you look historically back the last 20, 30 years, you can see a real clear curve on that graph no matter what you're charting.
You're
it's
right.
getting worse and worse and worse. Now, the question is, here we are in Alaska with up to 1 gigawatt on phase one, a billion watts, 4.7 billion watts on phase two, and our desired level, according to government documents that we obtained to put this book together, they want to get up to 100 billion watts.
My God.
Now the question is, where's the straw on that camel's back?
I want the average person out there, Doctor, needs to understand how much power that is. Now, the strongest AM radio station that I transmit on, legally in the U.S., is the big ones, you know, like KOMO, and there could be a whole list of them, are 50,000 watts, and you just said at the top of the project they're going to be talking about 100 billion watts.
That's the desired level according to the government record that we found, and that was in a document that the government, in the way they describe it, even denies that the GOT document exists, and yet we've got the copy of it. They consider it an unpublished document. Yet it's 613 pages long.
Wow.
And in the midst of that is this little section that sort of lays out where it was from the working group sessions of the early scientific researchers that were putting HARP together. It was a HARP planning memorandum, and it was for internal use only, and we were able to get a copy of it. I don't want to really say how, but it wasn't classified. It was just they denied that it was published, and they said it was a technical memorandum, and we cite it in the book, and we make it available to media when they ask for it. But what you're talking about in those power levels is huge. I mean, when you're talking about even at the levels of, say, 4.7 gigawatts up to, say, 10 gigawatts, we had Princeton, New Jersey physicist Dr. Richard Williams comment in our book. And the way, here's how he characterized it, okay? And this makes it pretty simple, I think. They refer at one point to the need to go at least 100 dBW. One way to visualize this power level is that a 10 billion watt generator running continuously for 1 hour would deliver a quantity of energy equal to that of a Hiroshima-sized atomic bomb.
Holy mackerel.
Okay, and now let's talk about that, because one of the applications of this transmitter also is to create an electromagnetic pulse, or an EMP.
Oh.
And before, the way those were created was upper atmospheric detonation of thermonuclear weapons. And
correct.
They create this energy pulse that knocks out electronic circuits over a very large area.
That's right.
Problem is, it's a little messy, okay, from a technological standpoint. But think about the rush now. Everyone's saying, okay, let's get rid of the thermonuclears. And you got to wonder, what do they got to replace it? Well, this technology, according to the patent, is exceptional for that application, because they
can create an EMP pulse,
right,
without a nuclear detonation.
Right. So you have an EMP without radiation, and you can directionally direct it using ionospheric mirrors.
How narrow do you think the beam width at the point back on Earth would be? Do you have any guesses?
Well, they're saying, like, my memory serves me, it's about 30 degrees.
30 degrees. All right. Well, listen, everybody, again, we're talking about radiation in frequencies between 1 and 30 hertz, which has a distinct biological effect on human beings. It confuses them. We really don't quite altogether know what it does, but it affects the biological human being. Physiologically,
well,
affects you.
I think we do know what it is. I mean, it will definitely disrupt mental function. There's no question. The literature is clear. And we lay that literature out in a very pragmatic way as we approach it. And we only cite military documents and mainstream science, mainstream media, because that's all you need. There's enough there.
All right. What have you got? You got confusion. What actually happens to a person subjected at what power levels? At these frequencies, what happens to that person?
At 1/50th, 1/50th power level that would naturally occur in the Earth, which is, you know, that's the power level necessary to create, say, mood swings, to create a state where you just can't think clearly, things are confused. And what you're talking about is it has to be the right waveform, pulsed at the right frequency, and that frequency range is at 1 to 30 hertz. Now, if you think about, let me just go through where that's at. In the lower range, say 1 hertz to around 4 hertz, is a state that you're in when you're in very, very deep sleep. The next level, which is called theta, which is running from about 4 to, say, 7 hertz, is a state that you're in sort of in a semi-sleep state. You might even hit some of that when you're awake. Alpha state, next state up, is a good state for creative work, creative thinking. And then above that, above, say, 13 hertz, you get into beta, which is sort of an awake, alert state. But the higher you go, the more agitated you get. So as you hit 30 hertz as a predominant brainwave frequency, that's what you're doing when you're screaming at somebody at a very loud decibel.
Or either that, or grabbing them by the throat and choking them.
Right, right. And so you've got this broad swing, but what happens is your brain waves, with the right pulse energy coming in, will lock on to that, and then you become, it's what's called brain entrainment. So the frequency locks on and causes a response, and that response works very quickly and was demonstrated at Yale University by Jose Delgado for 2 decades, first with electrodes implanted and then wirelessly using radio frequency as a carrier and pulsing it. And his work continues today in Madrid, at the University of Madrid in Spain. And it's well known that this effect occurs. There's a lot of literature that sort of lays that part of it out. But the biological effects, in fact, if you visualize the human body, all right, and start the way Western science approaches it, we start from the outside, we look at body parts, then we look at body components, then we look at chemicals and cells, and then we look at nothing else, basically. But when you look at what we really are, you start at an energy level, then you go to an atomic level, a molecular level, a chemical level, a body part level, cellular, and so on all the way up. So if you affect the energy level in a way that resonates, that pulses at the same frequency or in resonance with chemicals within the body, you can create amped up, if you will, chemical reactions that then manifest as disorders first in the cells and then later in body components and then in the body itself. So when you think about energy interactions with human beings, they're not detached. I mean, we are attached. And if you direct those in a certain way, you can create profound effects, and the literature is clear. Now, there's a lot of debate because people trained in traditional American medicine approach it from one angle. People trained in physics look at the human body, and they don't see any difference between physical applications in physics to human beings is any more than apply to anything else.
All right, and again, the military, to backtrack again, is telling us the HARP project, and I've seen the photos of the antenna arrays up there. Where is it located, by the way?
It's about 250 miles north east of Anchorage and about the same distance southwest of Fairbanks.
Okay. The stated goals of HARP, they say it's certainly harmless to human beings, and they're suggesting it's to look for underground caverns and bunkers and whatever, map the underground, and or to heat the ionosphere. Toward what end, Doctor?
They're saying for communication purposes.
Communication.
But when you look at HARP, think of this transmitter as a hammer, and you can build a whole lot of different things with that hammer, depending on the knowledge and intent of the operator. You can build that earth-penetrating tomography application, look into the earth. You can build the over-the-horizon radar application, which they talk about. You can build the communication application. Interesting thing about the communications applications is at the high enough power level, they can essentially, according to the patents, knock out communication land, sea, and air while using the same system to carry their own communications. In other words, they can wipe out the radio stations that we're talking on tonight, television, every bit of communication.
Wow.
And yet carry their own.
And yet communicate with, say, submarines at sea. So they're creating modulated EMP pulse,
right,
that is destroying other communications while allowing their communications.
Right. And we found a document. This one was a really profound document, and it's one that came very late in our research, but we did get it in the book, and it was by the International Red Cross in Geneva. And the text itself, I'm pulling it as I'm talking to you, was called Expert Meeting on Certain Weapon Systems and on the Implementation Mechanisms in International Law, and it's from June of 1994. And this specific document was very important because what it laid out is the various frequency ranges that you need for a number of effects using radio frequency or microwave weapon systems. And when we had our expert, if you will, in the radio frequency issues, look at that document and compare it to the HARP contract document, HARP will produce all of the effects I'm about to describe, which include biological effects as far as deleterious or negative biological effects causing debilitation, loss of mental function, to bit errors in computers. That's where the things aren't flowing right through the computers in such a way as it just are all garbled coming out, to melting circuits. I mean, this whole range of things based on how much energy and at what frequency ranges it's transmitted. So here's an international document that sort of lays out that, and it's the only document we ever found where it just matched. I mean, perfectly matched with the HARP specification. So now the question becomes, and this is the question everybody asks, well, would our government do that? Well, let me tell you.
Oh, hell yes.
Yeah, they certainly would. And when you look back on the history, and to quote a little bit, I'm going to pull up, let me pull this up because it's...
Well, the applications, the possible applications for a weapon system, they're so obvious that the question is almost not worth asking. Of course they would do it.
Right.
Of course they would research it. And I'm sure others are as well. But the big question is, do they know what the hell they're doing? And do they know what the effects will be? When they first detonated an atomic weapon, there were people who thought... Fortunately, it didn't happen, that air molecules might actually ignite or chain react, and we could blow up our whole atmosphere. Now, I'm not saying something like this will happen with HARP, but do they really know when they start pumping a hundred billion watts?
That's what they desire. What they have right now designed is for 1 billion watts, headed on phase two, which the contract is led on, but not funded yet, 4.7 billion watts, and then... It's modular. It's designed to be added to continuously.
Right.
What the question is, what will it do, and do they really know? I think all of the scientists involved on the front end of the project.
Yes.
Probably don't see the big picture, because the way the military works, just like in the Manhattan Project that you were referring to earlier,
all compartmentalized. Sure.
Do they know for sure what will happen? No. But the people running this program, you know, are people that are in the business of making the best killing system. So they're going to develop the best system they can. And when you look back on atomic research, they knew the effects of those blasts in Nevada. They knew what was going to happen all the way back 50 years ago. They just didn't bother to tell the American people about it.
All right. On that note, let's hold it right there. Dr. Nick Begich is my guest. He co-authored Angels Don't Play This Harp. And I would have to second that. Boy, is this ever fascinating. Hope you're tracking with us. More in a moment.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995.
Government lie to us about a project like this? No. What a traitorous thing to imagine. Would our government experiment on us without our permission? It's never happened. It never will happen. Our government? Never. Right, Doctor?
Wrong. In our research, we point to activities of the CIA with a number of experiments that they were involved with. One in particular that's gotten quite a bit of notoriety was the LSD experiments on 8,000 military personnel without their permission or consent. Military experimentation up here involved in Alaska during the Cold War, injecting native Alaskans with radioactive iodines without their permission or consent. When you look at the atomic program in Nevada, they did the atmospheric blast, assured everyone that everything was safe, and yet now, 50 years later, we found out that they know what they knew then, we know now. It just took us 50 years to catch up. What our book does is doesn't wait the 50 years. We found out what they're up to, we document it in a way that no one can deny, and yet it's today, and it is today in the sense that we can still do something about this project before it moves forward very much further. And I think the things that we're talking about and that we've talked about tonight, the idea of mental disruption, I mean, this hits the root of who we are as Americans, who we are as free people. When you can interfere with the way people think, you can forget about what we say, you can forget about the projection of what we might write. Because if you can't think clearly, none of those things matter. So this is really striking, and this is, from my political background, this is what strikes me the most. The most profound thing is, here's a technology that is capable of disrupting the way, you know, the way we think. And and going back to Zbigniew Brzezinski, who wrote in the early 70s about this technology, projecting that someday it would come about, he said, a more controlled and directed society would gradually appear, linked to technology. And then the quote that I pulled from his book was, unhindered by the restraints of traditional values, this elite would not hesitate to achieve its political ends by using the latest modern techniques for influencing public behavior and keeping society under close surveillance and control. Technological and scientific momentum would then be freed on the situation it exploits. Unquote. This was the national security advisor to Jimmy Carter, and he was predicting this technology within the book that I had mentioned earlier called Between Two Ages.
You know, it's a funny thing, Doctor. I recall some early comedies, and I can't recall the name of the show. It doesn't matter. I think it was Barney Miller or something, where people would come running in and claim that the telephone company microwave was causing their brain to go scattered and was affecting them, and, you know, they were total nutcases. And it's from comedy and science fiction to today's science reality. And this is really, actually, what HAARP truly may be.
That's correct.
Now, the questions I've got coming in by fax are as follows. For example, and these are really good questions. Would you ask your guest, Art, if there's any way to put together a building or, and this is going to sound crazy, let it be so, some sort of helmet or some sort of thing that would protect people from this radiation?
Yes, actually there is. And I spoke with Dr. Patrick Flanagan, who many of your listeners may be familiar with, and he was one of our technical advisors on the project. I met with him a couple of weeks ago, and this question keeps coming up. And what he has suggested, and I haven't got a parts list, but I'll give you the descriptor as he gave it to me, is if you take a white noise generator, disconnect the wires that go to the sound output of a white noise generator, hook those leads into a power amplifier on the input side of a power amplifier, and then on the output side of that power amplifier, if you connect a insulated wire, say stranded wire, 18 gauge, 16 gauge.
Let me stop you for a second. White noise, here, to give you an example, if I can get it going here. That's white noise. That's simply a combination of all noises coming out of a radio, right? When it's not tuned to anything specific.
Basically, yes. And by running it through the power amplifier, and then you take the output side of that power amplifier, connect an insulated wire lead, and run that wire lead around the area that you're looking to insulate around the effect. And here's what's going to happen. Is an ELF or an extremely low frequency, and this is helpful also for any ELF in the area, whether it's HAARP generated or generated by normal circuits within your house. What it'll do is it keeps the ELF from locking on to biological systems, because ELF in the range from, you know, 1 hertz up to about 100 hertz can lock on to a biological system and create a number of effects. What this does is keep it from locking on. The white noise, in fact, sets through the power amplifier, sets up a field that just disrupts ELF, and it keeps from locking on. So it's a way to insulate, at least within a confined area, against ELF. Now, Patrick is working on some things that might be a little more portable, because you can't walk around with power amplifiers and all of that. But that's down the road. At some point, we've got a newsletter coming out in January that's mentioned in the very last pages of the book, and we'll actually have a circuit design and the components, so you can go to a local Radio Shack or electronics store, get those components, and put something together on your own. And that's, you know, it's kind of something we want to make sure everyone is aware of as we get a regular parts list that makes it simple for people to deal with.
Now, what do we know about the present activation level of HAARP? In other words, has the HAARP begun to play yet?
Yes, it has, and they have run intermittently a series of tests. They started December 15th last year, which has been mentioned to us, correlated with an 8-state power outage on the same day.
Oh, do I remember that power outage.
Okay, well, that was the same day they activated HAARP in its first test phase.
I've got news for you. It was more than 8 states.
Okay.
They reported it in the press, I think, as 8 states, but I did an all-night show on it. It's the damnedest show I ever did. It was like the show on magnetism the other night. We got these really weird reports. Suddenly the power went out here, and simultaneously it went out across, I would say, almost the western third of the entire U.S. and Alaska. And I think that's exactly what you're talking about.
Well, it could have very well have been HAARP. I mean, it certainly is, you know, it's there, and what happens when you energize, it's following magnetic lines of force. So, you know, could it have been? Maybe so. It's pretty coincidental for all that to happen. But intermittently since then, they've run these various tests. Currently, what's planned for the winter is this earth-penetrating tomography, and it's kind of hung up in the national budget. They have $15 million budgeted for next year for testing that application. And kind of, here's an interesting side note. When they went to the Congress to get the funding for this project,
yes, sir,
they sold that Congress on this counterproliferation, nonproliferation application of the technology. And the Congress said to them in the Senate report, you can't have any more money till you make that a principal part of your project. And in effect, it delayed the project for a year, which has given gave us time to finish our work, get it out in front of the public, and is delaying it long enough for people to react. And maybe they won't get that second round of funding if enough people complain to the Congress.
Maybe. But, you know, these kind of projects seem to find a way and a route and funding somehow or another through some black project.
That's true. And let's talk about that real briefly, because the corporate chain on this project is really interesting when you talk about black projects. APTI was this little bitty subsidiary of ARCO Atlantic Richfield. And what they were was they reported $5 million a year in annual sales, and yet the initial HARP project was $30 million. That was the construction contract that they won. And they won it based on the proprietary or the special patents that they owned, which were these 12 we describe in the book.
Mm-hmm.
What they then did is sell out that subsidiary to a company called E-Systems, which was featured in the Washington Post and 60 Minutes early this year and late last year
as being
one of the most secret companies in the U.S. It has $2.1 billion in annual sales, most of which, $1.8 billion, is for security agencies, CIA, NSA, military intelligence, and $800 million of that are black projects, so secret even the Congress doesn't know what they're for.
Wow.
And then E-Systems, interestingly, got gobbled up in April of this year by a company called Raytheon, which was at that time the 42nd largest company on the Fortune 500 list.
Oh, yes.
And is a major weapons system manufacturer. In fact, the Patriot missile system is theirs.
Absolutely.
And they were, interestingly enough, one of the original bidders on the HARP project, and they didn't get the contract, but now they got it.
Oh, so they absorbed, Raytheon absorbed the project.
Yeah, they and all the patents. They bought out E-Systems, which bought out APTI, and so they ended up owning the project lock, stock, and barrel. And what this project is, and the way we can best characterize it, this is a ground-based Star Wars weapon system. And
it's going to get funded, Doctor.
Yeah, I think at some point it's going to, but people need to be aware of it, and people need to start focusing on what our government is doing, because this is just one more reflection of a government that's gone out of control, and it's being run by a bureaucracy that exists from administration to administration, from political group to political group. It doesn't matter whether it's Republicans, Democrats, Independents, because the underlying government is in fact the bureaucracy that stays for 20 and 30 years at a time. They don't go away with administration. They work these projects from start to finish over decades of time, not tied to election cycles. But people need to realize that, and people need to be conscious of it and start looking. They're going to jump in the game and get a handle on some of these kind of projects.
Well, one wonders if they can even jump that high. Doctor, here's a question. Keith in Wisconsin, WLIP, does the HARP project relate to the ELF project here in northern Wisconsin?
Yes, in this sense. I read a press report recently where one of the local congressmen from there, or senators, was suggesting that maybe they should defund that global tease, then what are we going to use? Well, what we're going to use is HARP, because HARP is a much more versatile technology. Instead of having the antennas stretched out miles and miles along the ground or under the ground, they can now have a modulated ionosphere and create this huge antenna in the sky, if you will, artificially using this pulsed energy and these ionospheric mirrors. So is it tied to it in the sense that it's a better technology from a military standpoint? It replaces what is currently existing in Wisconsin.
All right. As a ham radio operator, let me ask you this. We watch, if you listen at 18 minutes past the hour to the National Bureau of Standards, they will tell you whether we're subject to the A index, the K index, whether we're having a magnetic storm, whether the shortwave frequencies should be generally usable or are going to be in trouble, or what the situation is. Now, over the past couple of years, many of my friends and myself have noticed at times when there is no magnetic disturbance documented, and they watch it very carefully, the bands, nevertheless, can suddenly go dead instantaneously. It's the damnedest thing I've ever seen. You're hearing people from all over the world, and suddenly you couldn't hear somebody next door.
Well, these ionospheric heaters have been operating. I mean, they have one in Turismo, Norway, Arecibo, Puerto Rico, which incidentally, those two are being retrofitted to have the same antenna focusing ability.
Really?
And then you look at the five transmitters in the former Soviet Union. You look at, there's antenna arrays scattered throughout the world. And in fact, in the research, it shows clearly that they can create what amounts to an artificial
magnetic storm.
I mean, that's exactly what they can create. And
wow.
I mean, the difference is it's controllable. So they can, again, for knocking out communications deliberately, only by being able to pump huge amounts of energy and being able to manipulate that energy in such a way that, in fact, they could shut down everyone's communication.
All right, so they can do that at the power levels they're playing with presently, but you're saying that when it gets to the higher power levels, they can create an EMP, an electronic magnetic pulse, similar to that produced by the detonation of a nuclear device without the detonation of a nuclear device, and that could literally destroy computers everywhere in the targeted area.
Right. And one of the things that we found is the lab, the Philips Laboratory, that is doing this particular work. We got a listing of all of their major projects, and a number of those projects deal with what are called hardening technologies, the idea
yes.
of being able to develop weapons that aren't affected by EMP. So at the same
right.
time they're developing a system to wipe out everyone else's systems, they're developing the technology to protect our own. And all of that, you know, as a military application, people concerned about national defense, you know, we can all kind of embrace some of that. The problem is, on this particular project, it's all of those other effects that we cannot let go of. We have to remember what the biological sciences have told us and what they're showing us relative to energy's interaction with human beings and animals. And the issue of these magnetic anomalies, how much more energy can this planet absorb before there's another shift? And that's something that everyone is pointing to, whether it's from a religious perspective
or a
scientific perspective.
Yes, could it actually precipitate a shift?
That speculation is there, and there's also some research that suggests that it could. Once you hit a certain threshold, and this is what J.F. Gordon MacDonald said as a geophysicist and a science advisor to Lyndon Johnson in a book called Unless Peace Comes. He wrote a chapter entitled How to Wreck Your Environment. And what he shows is, and what he says is, that a very directed, pulsed electronic stroke in the ionosphere, a small input, can create a very profound and large output. And then he analyzes small inputs for large outputs in talking about melting of Antarctic. He talks about it in terms of creating earthquake activity, in terms of creating mental disruption over large areas. I mean, the man in that chapter of that book, which is available, I mean, you have to dig around. It's a 1969 book. But there it is. I mean, here's a guy that was one of the top flight scientists of his time, one of the top geophysicists who studied geophysical weapon systems as a specialty, who acknowledged then that once we had the technology for delivering the energy, you could create these effects. And we have that technology now in the HAARP project and projects like it scattered all over the world.
How do the people there in Anchorage and the surrounding area feel about all this?
Well, you know, really, we're the ones that broke the story because it was so complicated. No one in the media would really jump into it. It took a year of research. We had to let go of a lot of other projects in order to focus on it, and really the word is just starting to flow out. Our book has only been out since mid-September. Mm-hmm. It has gotten some good coverage here in Anchorage, and it's gotten good coverage throughout the state, and what we're seeing now is small groups of people forming together on their own to object to the technology.
I can imagine. All right, Doctor, look, we're at the top of the hour. I'm going to hold you over, and I'm going to turn you over to the audience. They've
Great.
Got a lot of questions, so stay where you are. Dr. Nick Begich is my guest, co-author of a book called Angels Don't Play This Harp, and they sure don't. Boy, is this not some story or what? An update, and back to Dr. Begich right after the news. Stay right there.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995. You're listening to Art Bell, Summer in Time. Tonight featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995.
Your attention, please. We've got a hot one going. His name is Dr. Nick Begich. He's in Anchorage, Alaska. And he is co-author of a book called Angels Don't Play This Harp. It's all about the Harp Project. And when you hear what Dr. Begich says about what the Harp Project is, if it doesn't have your attention, you're being affected already. All right, look, I've got a fax here that I'm going to read you. Not a fax, actually, but an email message from Stan Deo in Perth, Australia. Many of you have listened to the show for a while know of Stan. He is a researcher. Looking into a thermal imagery, satellite imagery of the Earth. And he sent me the following, and I'm going to read it to you. I can't verify it is so or not so, and I'm sure he can't either. So for what it's worth, Art, I'm hesitant to announce the following, but I feel I must, in light of the unofficial reports of magnetic field anomalies in California 2 days ago. He refers to this program. The official report which I sent you says no anomalies occurred, yet I do continue to get pilots' reports, etc., saying, indeed, it occurred. For 4 days, I have been watching three tremendous thermal changes grow in size off the coasts of Nicaragua, which, by the way, is now spouting a new volcano, a very violent one, the Guatemala-Mexican border in Baja California up to San Francisco. I have not posted these on my webpage because I'm not sure yet what to say. Florida, the Bahamas, Chile, Argentina, Northern Australia, Southern Coast Australia, Adelaide, North Island, New Zealand, Romania, Bulgaria, Turkey, Japan, and the Kamchatka Peninsula should all be on the alert for action as well. I'm still trying to assess the changes here. Storms may be confusing the mantle's thermal effects along the U.S. East Coast. For those who have access to my webpage, use my homepage to go to the Otis Thermal Change page of the U.S. Navy. Download the recent thermal anomaly imagery. Look at the red and dark blue areas. These are where the next actions may be. I'm not sure of this call, but I think we may have a problem brewing here. Regards, Stan Deo, Perth, Australia. Stan is presently at a wedding reception, or I'd have him on the air right now, along with Dr. Begich, but we're going to ask Dr. Begich about this in a moment. There's been a lot of technical information given to you in the last couple of hours by Dr. Begich. If you have questions or don't understand portions of it or want clarification or have other questions, your opportunity to ask is coming right up. We're going to open the phones. First, though, I'm going to ask Dr. Begich. Doctor, the weather is very weird. The predicted Earth changes by psychics and sensitives and all the rest of it seemed to all coincide toward what I call a quickening. I'm sure you've heard me mention it.
Yeah.
Is it possible that Project HARP is either responsible for or is accelerating a natural process underway? I'm asking a very broad question.
Okay, we actually dedicated about 50 pages of our text to weather modification applications of this technology. And the answer is yes, it could in fact enhance or further what is actually otherwise might be occurring naturally. And something to keep in mind, and let's talk about weather modification just for a moment, because we haven't even covered that in the course of this last couple hours.
That's right, yes.
One of the ideas was that what HARP could create is by forcing the energy up, and if you can visualize pushing the atmosphere up at the same time, and then creating drag across, in other words, moving jet streams or weather patterns, was one of the original applications envisioned by Bernard Eastland when he invented the very first patents that are now being used in designing and having been used in building the HARP system.
Right.
Okay, so what you in fact do is by changing those jet streams, places that were dry become wet, places that were wet become dry. I mean, you can do that kind of thing if you can generate enough energy to push things up. Now, another application that Dr. Eastland didn't speak to, but we have seen references to and we cite those within the text, is the idea of creating standing waves that sort of block energy fronts or weather fronts, if you will. And by triangulating a couple of these ionospheric heaters so that they hit, their energy hits at the same point, thereby creating a standing wave that sort of blocks a weather front. And there has been reports of these anomalous standing waves, and they were attributed by some people, were speculated that they were Russian former Soviet Union transmitters being used right. In that way.
All right, let me ask this. Could you, for example, with it stall a weather front over the northwest, say, Washington State, and make it rain?
There is a lot of research that supports that, and I believe the answer to that is yes. And if you look back to the history of the United States on weather modification, going back to the 50s and 60s and all the way up until 1976, and the reason 1976 is a key year, that's the year that over 70 countries signed an international agreement saying that they would not use weather modification techniques in military applications. In other words, by 1976, the
wow.
technology had advanced enough for the UN to intervene and say, hey, wait a minute, we don't want these kinds of things utilized in a warfare situation. So then they defined the perimeters under which they could be used domestically. And then in one most recent report that we got from the Department of Commerce that was referencing the HAARP project, trying to explain that the HAARP project wasn't exceeding those perimeters. Okay, they didn't say we're doing weather modification. They just mm-hmm. wrapped themselves around the international agreement and said we're not exceeding it because it's not of the size and magnitude that would create these kind of anomalous occurrences. But the fact is the technology has been here since the early 70s and into the 60s, and they actually felt the need to sign that international agreement, to which the United States is a signatory. And this particular project and projects like it that have the potential of crossing international borders, in the case of Alaska, those international borders are Canada, which is just a couple hundred miles from the HAARP site, and on the other end, several hundred miles, maybe as much as 800 miles to the Siberian Soviet Far East.
All right, you heard me read the facts from Stan Dale. And he watches satellite imagery and looks at what he calls hotspots on Earth. I wonder if this mirror effect that you talk about, produced by a HAARP with focused energy, could begin producing Earth changes that would be reflected or seen by people like Stan Deo as heated portions of the Earth.
Yes, I think that's probably very possible, because it's going to be a relative heat compared to the area around it, and I think
exactly.
that's probably how the imaging shows up.
Exactly.
And so, you know, would it show up in that way? And I think the answer is yes. And going back to the geophysicists that we cite in our text, and we used a lot of advisors. I mean, we used atmospheric physicists, biochemists, physiologists, radio engineers, lots of folks proofed our work before we went to the presses to make sure that we were sound on the science. And all of those things are possible, because the concept for people to keep in mind is that very small input can create very large output once a system is already approaching a threshold. And anyone who can see can't deny that the Earth planet, as a planetary body, is reaching those thresholds, both in weather pattern anomalies, earthquake activities. We even show research where tidal activity is shifted from in terms of the North Sea, over a 30-year study showing that actual tides and actual wave heights have progressively and steadily increased in the North Sea. And we show the research, quoting New York Times, Washington Post, and other major media, quoting, you know, scientific studies showing how that has been tracked and tracked over a long period of time.
Doctor, I'm also tracking a number of other anomalies that might be related. One of them is the Antarctic, where a large chunk of ice, and I mean large, is beginning to crack.
Right, and that'll split that ice shield in half. And when that path slides into the ocean, they're speculating, ocean height rises of up to 300 feet.
That's right.
And we're familiar with that research. And when you think about the energy, once it hits these magnetic lines of force up here in the subarctic and arctic regions,
yes, sir,
it hits those lines of force, and what they found is that it then travels those magnetic lines of force all the way to the other end. So the energy actually starts here, and then if you look in the back of our text, and I know you have it there, there's a bunch of diagrams, and one of those actually shows this effect creating this envelope around the planet. But what it doesn't indicate is what happens when that energy already reaches an area that everyone knows is destabilized right now, and that's the Antarctic. It's at a point where what happens if, and if you look back on that geophysicist I quoted earlier, J.F. Gordon MacDonald, who was a UCLA geophysicist science advisor to Johnson, he indicated exactly that. I mean, when you look at his work in the book Unless Peace Comes, he indicates that a very small amount of activity in the Antarctic could cause that shelf to slide into the ocean, causing those ocean heights and basically flooding everything that's on the coast of every
country.
Next
item is, small indicator perhaps, but fishermen in the North Atlantic right now are reporting the doggonest thing they've ever seen. They've never seen anything like it. Fish that are normally tropical, Caribbean area type fish, are showing up in the North Atlantic, and they can't figure it. They think it's got something to do with the warming of the ocean.
Okay, there's two ways to look at it, and there's a lot of debate about this in scientific circles in terms of what causes animals to migrate. And some people say it's the relationship to gravity. Some people say it's the sighting of the sun. Some people say it's water temperatures. There's a lot of different speculation. But some of the most recent and most provoking kind of speculation, things that we've seen, is that within the brains of fish and mammals, they found that magnetite exists, which is, you know, this magnetic mineral. And what they're basically asserting is that perhaps that really what guides all of these biological systems in terms of direction, mm-hmm, is in fact magnetic lines of force. And that,
boy,
when those get out of whack, animals are disoriented and show up in the wrong places. Or in the case of whales beaching on the shore, dolphins beaching on the shore, pigeons not making it back where they're supposed to go.
That's right.
All of that is going on right now. And how can it uniformly be explained by one thing or the other? That seems to be the only consistent thing in all of those systems.
No, but I'm beginning to see a pattern. I'm starting to see a pattern. In other words, all of these anomalies do begin to show a pattern. Now, whether it relates to what HARP is doing or whether HARP will simply magnify it,
right,
I don't know.
And I think the magnification is the issue. But again, going back to what we said earlier, you have to think of living systems starting as energy, and that energy has an effect. You have atoms, then you have molecules. And what human beings are, and what everything is the outward, our form is the outward expression of our internal arrangement of atoms, which are absolutely impacted by every kind of electromagnetic energy form in some way.
And I want to say this again. For those who don't think that they would be developing this as a weapon system, you all are out of your minds, because HARP potentially is a project that could focus an energy beam of low-frequency radiation bounced off the ionosphere and directed, for example, to a battlefield where it could completely disorient the enemy. At least that's the idea. And so if you could do that, it would be worth a hell of a lot of black budget money to go after.
And let me tell you something. Where we show that particular application is in a document by Maxwell Air Force Base, and it's called Low Intensity Conflict in Modern Technology. And it was written in June of 1986 and can be obtained through interlibrary loan through most public libraries. But guess who wrote the foreword to that?
Who?
None other than Congressman Newt Gingrich.
You're kidding.
Nope. It's right there in the document. And, I mean, when you look at that and you think, now here's the guy who's the third most powerful man in the United States House. Now, when my father was deceased, he was lost on a plane with Hale Boggs, who was at that time the Speaker of the House here in Alaska. Now Newt Gingrich, third most powerful man in the United States, in terms of if something happens to the president or vice president, this
sure
guy drives the truck.
Absolutely.
And here's a guy who embraces these what they call non-lethal weapon systems, Star Wars weapon system, as far back as 1986 when he wrote the foreword for this document. And this document is available. People can get it and look at it themselves. And when they look at those sections on creating artificial EMP and using radio frequency weapon systems for debilitating human beings, the military doesn't announce this stuff in advance until the technologies are far enough along to know they can apply them. And this is 86. This is 10 years ago. In this last decade, they have now got the most incredible delivery system ever anticipated by anyone, and that is the HARP technologies, what they're testing right now in the very early stages.
All right, Doctor, look, we've laid it out pretty well. I promised phone lines. We didn't get to them this half hour. We're going to get to them next half hour. Stay right where you are. My guest is Dr. Nick Begich. You've had it laid out for you. If you have questions, I'm really going to get to them in this coming half hour, I promise. Fascinating stuff. Angels Don't Play This Harp is the name of the book. And it's really appropriate. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995. Presents Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight's program originally aired December 1st, 1995.
Welcome to the program, those of you who join at this hour. Anything is possible tonight, anything at all. Who knows? But then again, that's kind of the way I like it. Angels Don't Play This Harp. Subtitle, you'll like the subtitle, Advances in Tesla Technology. My guest is Dr. Nick Begich. He's in Anchorage, Alaska. He's actually near the HARP project, as I am near the area called Dreamland. Doctor, are you there?
Yes, I am.
All right, you ready for a few phone calls? We've got to do this.
Let's go.
Let's rock. All right, east of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Where are you calling from, please?
Hi, Art. This is Ron in Memphis on WMC.
Memphis, Tennessee, all right.
You bet. Hi, Doctor.
Hi, how are you?
I was thinking about all the different scenarios you had set up here, and I actually had two questions. It seems possible with this technology that you'd be able to focus an energy beam onto, like, an aircraft, a ship, or even a submarine, and create a sort of force field. And that force field would be able to conceal a craft. And if that's possible, it can maneuver just about anywhere in the world undetected. Does this hypothesis concur with the HAARP Project experiments?
You know, I never. This is the first time that anyone's ever raised that. So to react to it, I can't. But you know, it seems that certainly there must be someone out there that that could react to that better than I. I just don't know. You know, and it kind of leads me to the next point is, you know, a lot of the stuff that we were able to accumulate on this has been from people listening to us or reading something that we've written and sending something our direction. And we've been able to build, since we published the book, a pretty substantial file that will lead to something probably down the road as far as republishing, because we are getting a lot of information. That application, I'll look for things as time goes on. I'm a fairly good researcher, and having heard it, I'll keep my eyes open.
Well, it's actually not that far technologically, using a lot of the same technology as was allegedly used in the Philadelphia experiment.
Right, and I have read some of the materials on that. So, you know, is it possible? Probably so. I don't think anything that human beings can conceive you can say is impossible. I think that we're you know, that's kind of what we are, you know.
Answer is, it could ultimately be any. The other question, caller?
Art, yeah, actually that leads into my second question. As I remember, Doctor mentioned that there's a HAARP array located in Puerto Rico.
What it is it's called, at Arecibo, and they refer to these as ionospheric heaters. HAARP is the specific ionospheric heater located in Alaska.
Oh, I see. Well, then we mentioned the Philadelphia experiment, and I sort of put the two together and came up with the next question. That is, if there's a lot of magnetic anomalies and mysterious weather patterns that are reported in the Bermuda Triangle, and
right.
I was just curious if there was any previous experiments that may be related to this project may have actually been tied to maybe some of the mysteries surrounding the Bermuda Triangle.
All right, we'll hold it there. That's a pretty wide one to jump through, but
You know, the fact is, if you look at where they're located, you know, there are anomalous occurrences there, which again would indicate that you have an area on the planet that's already got some unique characteristics
mm-hmm.
that are unusual, that are different from other places. So what happens when you add energy into a system like that?
Good question.
You know, your guess is as good as mine. Is it going to create a lesser effect? I doubt it.
All right. With respect to protection, could you please ask Dr. Begich what power levels you would need with a white noise generator to be effective? In other words, would it need to be X number of watts for X number of square feet of protection?
You know, that's, again, the person that I got the information from on how to link it up, what basic components, was Dr. Patrick Flanagan. And we are going to publish that in newsletter form, and everyone that has gotten a book will get a copy of that.
Oh.
Perhaps when we have the actual circuit design, we can get that to you, Art, and you can get that to the listeners, because we sure do want people to know the specifics. But if you've got an electronics background, you can configure what we described earlier. The power
Absolutely.
Level, I'm just going to have to get it for you and get it back to you.
All right. That would be important. From Alaska, right up there by you, 75 miles north of HAARP, is this why we have only 3 or 4 inches of snow here? Normally, we've got 5 or 10 feet by now. Lee from Summit Lake, Alaska.
You know, that's come up because here in Anchorage we're dealing with about an inch of snow but a really cold temperatures, and that is unusual. Again, in this specific case, I don't think so. I don't think it's directly related to HAARP because it's been on intermittently, and I just don't think so. But, you know, is it creating a worsening or is it enhancing an already a naturally occurring weather pattern?
Maybe.
That could very well be.
All right. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Where are you calling from, please?
Seattle.
Seattle. Yes, sir.
Hi. I happened to see an article, was it back in the 70s, in a kind of a tabloid magazine. It kind of had some different things, but it mentioned geophysical warfare. And they'd first observed some stuff in southern Germany, where that people had naturally become affected by the weather or the electromagnetic field around in the area. Has there been any research as to the various types of behaviors that can be caused by EMF?
Or all right.
Yes, there has. And when you speak about geophysical warfare, that's not a new concept. At Hascom Air Force Base in Massachusetts, it's sort of the hub of geophysical warfare research and experimentation, as well as there's a lot going on in Los Alamos, which, you know, is kind of the black box capital of the world. But, you know, there is a lot of that going on. But as far as those subtle effects that low levels of energy can create in biological systems, that's well known. And what happens, here's the interesting thing. There's the Navy, which is a joint partner with the Air Force on HAARP specifically. They've cataloged over 1,000 international studies on the effects of low levels, what they call non-ionizing, non-heat-producing energy levels of various types from the electromagnetic spectrum, their effects on human physiology. And a big part of those say there is no effect, and another big part of those say there is huge effects. And here's the interesting thing. When the military is going after funding for weapon systems that utilize RF, like these systems talked about in modern low-intensity conflict and modern technology, then they point to the studies that show this unusual low energy output, high effect biologically. And then here in Alaska, where they're trying to say, oh, we're just studying the upper atmosphere and the ionosphere, then they blow all that off and they point to the other literature. It's kind of like a lawyer going into a law library. Mm. Depending on what side of the team he's on, he pulls the right text and makes the argument. But all the texts exist to make either argument.
All right, try this one out. Here is a question from the 747 pilot. Doctor, what effect might HAARP have, ELF, EMP signals, on sensitive electronic EFIS cockpit displays in aircraft like Boeing 737, 57, 67, 47s, MD-11s, so forth and so on? In other words, if they fly within the range of this, what would the influence be? The above-named aircraft, you see, rely on internal reference units to maintain aircraft attitude, in other words, level,
right,
upright flight.
I'm familiar with this concern because it has been explored here in Alaska. And what the concern also involves is the more modern aircraft, instead of cabling, linking the flaps, they're done by, they're moved by radio signals activating motors or what have you to cause those flaps to move, which actually make the planes go up and down. And so the concern is, well, will this interfere with those radio transmissions, or will it create, will it make those flaps move when they limit the pilot from being able to control them?
Exactly.
And what the Air Force has done is, the answer is yes, it can. And the Air Force here in Alaska, when they set this system up, set up a radar that supposedly is supposed to capture anyone coming into the area and shut the transmitter off if they get too close, so they don't create the effect. But here's the other part of that equation. At the same time they're saying they're guarding against it, in the documents that we found that they produced, they're looking to create what they're describing as a runaway effect in the ionosphere, where there's a huge energy effect. And then the question is, can they shut it off? And that's a really, really important question for pilots to be asking.
It is. And in addition, when they go to this 100 billion watt mode, and you're talking about a 30 degree beam width coming back to Earth, how do you control aircraft in such a wide zone as that?
Exactly. And that 100 billion watt, again, I want to emphasize, that was the desired level in Technical Memorandum 195 by the government. The absolute required level is up to 10 billion watts, which is where they're headed with this project in the short term.
Everybody needs to know this is not science fiction. Some of it is speculation about effect, but they are really doing this. This project is now built and beginning to operate. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hi.
Is this technology similar at all to pulse-modulated RF pain field generators?
All right. Before we answer that, where are you?
Oh, I'm in Memphis.
Memphis, all right.
You know, again, you're talking about a small weapon system to create a physiological effect, what they're calling non-lethal weapons. And we explore that whole non-lethal area in the context of our text. We look at what the U.S. Justice Department's doing for the development of those weapon systems. We look at the DOD, Department of Defense, transfer of that technology to Department of Justice for domestic uses, and we analyze that and we break down the documents. Could this, in fact, create that effect over a large area? The answer is yes. At the right power levels, modulated at the right frequency, you can create those effects. And those are the things we're concerned about. This is a giant non-lethal weapon on the one hand, and that's such a misnomer. I mean, non-lethal, what's that mean? I mean, it's a word they're using to sort of downplay these weapon systems. And whenever they refer to them now, you won't see them talking too much about microwave weapons anymore. Now what they're talking about is things that dissolve rubber tires and cause people to get caught up in gooey, sticky stuff.
Right, and also who, even if it doesn't move flaps, I don't know anybody out there who wants a mentally confused 747 pilot. First time caller line, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hi.
Hi, Art.
Where are you, sir?
Jim in Positas, New Mexico.
All right.
And I'm a 747 pilot.
Okay.
About 3 weeks ago, flying between, actually New York, up over Canada to Anchorage. We have a big base up there. The airplane has three autopilots. And the airplane went into a slow roll to the left, and we were running the airplane on three INS units, all intermixed, talking to each other.
All right.
Okay. And the airplane turned to the left, reached about a 30-degree bank, disconnected the autopilot, tried B autopilot, same thing, C autopilot, same thing. And this lasted for about 15 minutes. We were hand-flying the airplane.
In other words, you had triple redundancy, and in each case they were being affected in a similar way, nearly impossible.
That's correct. And when you're running in the INS mode, the compass system, the main compass system, is oriented to true north.
Yes, sir.
However, next to that is a radiomagnetic indicator that is referenced to magnetic north.
So you're saying there was a, you're speculating there was a change in magnetic north.
Yes, yes. And also enough.
And where again did this occur, please?
Around Whitehorse.
Around
that would be within, you know, I mean, HAARP is at Gakona, Alaska, which if you're familiar with that, that's not very far away.
I see.
You're within a few hundred miles of the HAARP transmitter.
All right, sir. Well, we
had no idea what was going on. And then later we tried re-engaging the autopilot one by one. They all worked fine. And the rest of the flight in Anchorage was uneventful.
All right, thank you. Now, that's pretty serious stuff.
That's exactly the kind of thing that we're talking about. This is serious business. You're talking about technologies that are not so difficult to understand when you think about how do you translate it out. And that was really our role when we wrote our book, was to translate complex science into easy-to-understand terms, yet leaving the science intact so you can read it at any level and understand it. And it is an important book. And again, if I can give that number for folks to get that, I sure would like to.
Yeah, you can. Of course you can. We're not done. You're not done. We can't leave it here. East of the Rockies, if you've got a quick question for Dr. Nick Begich, you're on the air. Where are you calling from, please?
This is Dave in Illinois.
Hi, Dave.
Hi. I have a computer program that I've had for a few years. It's designed to allow a person basically to manipulate his own moods by flashes of light on the computer monitor.
Yes.
Right.
And I was wondering, I've used it and it does work, definitely. It operates between 1 and 30 hertz.
Right. It's a brain entrainment device, and there's numbers of those that you can get now. They're fairly well available, both in using light-sound combinations and also using electric current, and they're being used in a number of ways. There's also a whole system of electrolaser acupuncture applying the same principles to creating very large effects with very small inputs.
All right, and so that the doctors stand by, so that the audience understands the magnitude of what we're talking about, the science is real, the project is real. The scale is absolutely enormous. This affects people's thinking. You know, what they used to call mind control in the science fiction books, that's what we're talking about. Angels Don't Play This Harp. My guest is Dr. Nick Begich. He will be back, as will we.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995. Somewhere in Time on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995.
Sally Ho in the nighttime, all-night live talk radio. It's your turn with Dr. Nick Begich. He's in Alaska. He's co-authored a book called Angels Don't Play This Harp. Have you ever felt a sudden, unexplainable mood swing? Could it have been harp? Yes. It could be. Are they going to run up the power and run up the bill and really get going with harp? Well, that is the plan. Will it get funded? Some people say no. Others say the funding to continue harp and enlarge harp is a done deal. I think I'm one of those people. I'm sure it's going to get funded. If this is really what they say it is, you know it's going to get funded. We'll be back to Dr. Begich in a moment. Back now to Alaska and Dr. Nick Begich. Doctor?
How are you?
Very well, thank you. You're doing quite a marathon here. But this is, I think this is very, very important. It's something the American people have got to know about. And a lot of people out there listening, probably their eyes glaze over a little at the technical details. But, folks, this is, I guess, Tesla technology being applied in a, I don't want to say a haphazard, but in terms of the effect it's going to have on our Earth, a kind of a irresponsible way. I mean, without knowing what you're doing to the environment you've got to live in, it's a little irresponsible. Would you use that word?
Yeah, and you know, it's going to lead me to two points that we've missed. The first point is, you know, has the government tried this kind of irresponsible thing in Alaska before?
Have they?
And let's talk about that. In early 1960s, Edward Teller, who was like the father of the nuclear age, if you will, came to Alaska with the idea of detonating 6 thermal nuclear bombs to create a bay here, to excavate a bay. The University of Alaska Fairbanks, which is the same university that's supporting this project through their Geophysical Institute, supported that project. Now, anyone proposing that in 1996, they'd be laughed out of the room as totally insane.
Absolutely.
And yet, here they were. And the only people that stopped that project in the early 60s was the biological team that happened to be assigned to that project, who was able to raise enough of an international complaint, if you will, that they actually shut it down and didn't do it. Instead, they made the experiments, actually, unfortunately, Art, in your neighborhood in Nevada.
Yes.
But they didn't do it here, and it was stopped by biological scientists. And Edward Teller came to Alaska just at the beginning of the HAARP project, announcing this wonderful new weapon system that they could operate on the North Slope of Alaska. And I believe it was this system. And what's interesting about that is when you look at the patents about the ideal location for these kinds of transmitters, it's the North Slope of Alaska, because it's at the North Slope of Alaska where the magnetic lines of force intersect the Earth. The closer you can get to that, the easier it is to get the energy into those magnetic lines of force, because it's intended to travel along them to create this huge effect over a large area. The other point that they make is that it just so happens that the North Slope of Alaska is holding trillions and trillions of cubic feet of natural gas without a market. They're not moving that gas anywhere but pumping it right back into the ground, because there's no gas line coming out of Alaska. The other thing that people may not be aware of is there's a lot of national debate on opening the ANWR, which is a wildlife refuge. When you look at the map of Alaska on the right side of Prudhoe Bay where the oil is, and we're pumping 2 million barrels of oil at peak out of there right now, about 1.5 million barrels a day. But on the left-hand side is a Naval Petroleum Reserve, the National Petroleum Reserve, which has numbers of wells that have been capped off but drilled to delineate fields that covers a vast, vast area. Excuse me. When you look at that area, it's the size of many states. Maybe as big as the state of, let me think here, a state to give it some proportional reference, probably the size of Wisconsin, sitting there, that's basically petroleum reserve. So, and here it is. It's a Naval Petroleum Reserve. Within the middle of that reserve, this system is designed to be modular, movable, and to be able to add on to it incrementally without throwing away any of the old components. In other words, they can move this to set up a site. It didn't take that long. It took about 3 months to erect, most of the time spent putting in a gravel pad. So here you have the ideal location, the necessary energy reserves owned by the federal government to affect this kind of system. And what Teller was telling us was that they were going to put them across the northern portion of Alaska, which in fact would give you huge power capabilities, because there are these generators that they have now that weigh about 40,000 pounds that'll generate 10 megawatts of power. And remember, a megawatt in is a gigawatt out.
That's right.
So here you have the ability to set up these facilities across the North Slope. And these gas fields, these aren't like oil fields in some parts of the world that pump out, you know, a 25, 50 barrels of oil a day and a little bit of natural gas. These are pumping out thousands of barrels of oil per well per day, and many, many, many cubic feet of natural gas potential that's being reinjected in the field. So one gas well could generate the kind of gas necessary to produce the electricity to produce this kind of effect. And they're small enough.
So in other words, they've got the natural resources to drive the generators to produce the power they need to do what they're about to do.
Exactly. And the other part is these are the old dew line sites where they had the radar sites to protect us from incoming. So they already have airstrips, infrastructure. Everything is already in place.
I've got you. All right. Let's go back to the phones. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hi.
Hi.
Where are you?
I'm from Minnesota, out of KFTP.
Yes, sir.
Yes, what concerns me, and from a lot of studies of my own, is that using this HAARP program, I'd like to ask Dr. Begich, if that couldn't be used in Bosnia, Croatia, and Serbia, where you not only have their armies and their people, but you're also going to have the Russians in there along with the Americans.
That's true.
Now, can that be zeroed in certain areas, either on the masses in certain cities,
all right.
Also individuals, so their actions or reactions can be controlled? And also, does Mr. Gingrich, President Clinton, and those high up in office in American politics know about this right now?
All right, that's a good question. We'll hold it there. First, he raises a very interesting question with respect to Bosnia. If you can use HAARP technology to irritate human beings, to drive them to irrational acts even, and we certainly have lots of irrational acts going on in this country and elsewhere, totally irrational, could it be used the other way around?
Yes.
In other words, could you calm people, literally almost putting them into a comatose or sleep state?
Yes, you can. In fact, there was a device used by the Russians during the Vietnam War called the LIDA device, L-I-D-A. And that device was used for placing prisoners of war in trance, and it was using a radio frequency to do it. And what it did is put them in trance, put them in a very relaxed sleep state where then they could extract intelligence from them. What has happened since then is the development of a new class of weapons that are, you know, HARP is like the biggest one there is, but, you know, scaling it down to battlefield type equipment, the answer is yes. I believe that the U.S. government and other governments have this technology now. And this, you know, and this kind of begs the other question, and you know, my area of research before jumping into this project was electrophysiology, and basically the bright side of this technology, in the sense that what's going on with brain entrainment technologies, there's a whole array of equipment and research happening all over the world. I just returned from a conference in Sri Lanka that was an alternative medicine conference, 67 countries represented, talking about all of the things that are happening in these areas. And there's a lot going on. This same basic knowledge, the same basic science can be applied to living systems in a positive way. The kinds of things that are happening with this technology, dealing with, say, hyperactive children, for instance,
sure,
where their brainwave frequencies are at a higher rate than they need to be, and they can't get focused and they can't concentrate.
Right.
These same brain entrainment technologies, when deliberately used in a positive way, can slow that brain activity into the range where a child can learn.
Most technologies, powerful technologies, they can be used for the good or the bad.
Exactly.
All right. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hi.
Yes, good morning, Art. Quick comment. Incidentally, I guess you knew that Secretary Perry came out of the exotic weaponry part of the Pentagon when they put him in. But
yes.
You know, going back a few years in this, resonances were noted in geophysical magnetic measurements, gravitational measurements, and this sort of thing. And the people wonder how, you know, a little bit of power, and of course, even a gigawatt many gigawatts are relatively small compared to nature's forces. But still, when you're exciting resonances, and people could do this by holding down a piano string an octave away and slam, you know, a string either side, you know, they will find that the resonance of that string is affected. But there was a book written called The Body Electric by Robert Becker, and a chapter called Maxwell's Silver Hammer might be of interest to people, and I suggest that they get the book.
We quote Becker extensively in our text. We quote his book Cross Currents in particular, and you know, all of what you're saying is correct, and it's the idea of small input, large output, and if it's at the right frequency in the right way, you can create profound effects.
And you think that's exactly what HARP is going to do?
Exactly. And what we had said earlier, and I think several hours ago,
yes,
was the idea that Jose Delgado, while working at Yale University, one of the brightest folks in terms of this kind of technology, in terms of brain entrainment and manipulation of brain patterns, found that energy levels at 1/50th, 1/50 of the Earth's naturally occurring energy, was sufficient as long as the energy was rhythmic. You know, or the frequency was rhythmic and in the right waveform. So in that sense, you know, we have tremendously more energy available with HARP and systems,
sure,
like HARP to create those effects.
Well, to imagine that our government would not, given the opportunity, like to be able to control behavior around the world or in areas of conflict remotely, electronically, to imagine they would not move forward in these areas, you would have to be one of the more naive people walking the face of the planet. Wild card line, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hi.
Hi, KABC Los Angeles.
Yes, sir.
Two questions, Dr. Begich. Would this HARP have any effect on what they call the Schumann resonance? And also, Vladimir Zhirinovsky, that Russian, mentioned in a speech one time a thing called a lipton. Now, would that be similar to what you're talking about, that beam weapon, or like a scalar weapon?
Okay, let's take the first part of the question first. And you're going to have to restate it because now it's getting late.
Schumann, the Schumann resonance.
Okay, Schumann resonance.
Right.
The answer is yes, okay? But, you know, the Schumann resonance at 7.83 hertz, which is sort of the natural pulsation of the Earth, it does vary from place to place slightly, okay?
Okay.
But if you zero in on that resonance and you are pulsing energy at the same frequency, then you're disturbing the Earth itself. And in other words, you can create this small input again, large output. If they hit that window frequency that's at the right pulsation of already naturally occurring frequencies, they can create a very large output. And that's where, when we were talking earlier, could it create a pole shift? Could it create some kind of a magnetic shift or some kind of other, you know, potential disaster? I think the answer is yes. If it's at the right frequency, right energy level, that resonance effect is extremely powerful. Now, going back to the question about Zaranovsky and what he was saying, I believe this is exactly the class of weapons and weapons similar to this that he was speaking about. And I think the scalar technologies, which is a whole nother area that you know, we could spend 4 hours on that as well. And it's an area that, from my perspective, I just don't have enough. It would take me another year of research to come back and talk 4 hours and feel like I could be halfway intelligent about it. But the fact is, that's a whole new area, and there's a lot of things going on in that area. I believe that our government, Soviet government, and other developed governments have those kinds of technologies. But the HARP system itself, generating scalar waves is kind of the wrong word, but scalars, is certainly one of the capabilities when you think of them creating standing waves using two of these, you know, creating those scalar effects.
All right, you got a second part of the question?
Oh, I was just going to tell them, if you get a chance, watch a science fiction movie called Quiet Earth. It's not exactly dealing with this, but it's kind of similar.
Same idea. All right, thank you. Thank you very much for the call. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hello?
Yeah, I wanted to say, if you direct a beam towards Moscow accidentally on wrong frequencies, can the mood swings make it so bad that they fire nuclear weapons at us?
Well, I suppose you wouldn't want to irritate the Russians any more than you had to, would be the answer to that. Whether you cause them to fire nuclear weapons, I think, is a very different kind of question, impossible to answer. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Would-have-been. Wildcard Line, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hi.
Hello. How's it going tonight? This is Downtown Dave in Anchorage, Alaska.
Well, all right. Anchorage to Anchorage.
How are you doing, Dave?
Good, good. Nick, I'm the guy that laid your carpet and introduced you to the Art Bell Show.
Oh, great. Yeah, I do remember you. How are you doing?
Good. I never imagined you'd be on Art Bell. But what do you think are the religious implications of Project HARP, like your comments? Thank you.
All right. Religious implications?
Well, you know, I've read most of the major religions to some degree in terms of study, and a lot of the minor religious philosophies. And kind of where I'm at is, you know, people kind of arrive at the same point from a lot of different directions. And there's a lot. And, you know, we're at the end of the millennium. There's a lot of speculation in religious quarters and by psychics, by all kinds of people. And then here we are on the science side of that equation. And yet we're coming, you know, we're sort of converging on the same sort of conclusion.
Yeah, I've always really wondered whether someday science will reach out and touch religion or the other way around. It might happen. We've got to move quickly here. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Begich. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Fairbanks.
Alaska. All right, good. Go ahead.
You mentioned that this project could be used to control people's attitudes.
Yes.
Well, what if the government wanted to go ahead with their plans to establish a new world order? Could this be used to control people's attitudes to accept that?
You know, that book I quoted earlier called Between Two Ages by Zbigniew Brzezinski, people who have that political belief structure in terms of new world order, we'll immediately zero in on Brzezinski as being one of the big players in that whole line of thinking in terms of having that happen. If people read that book, it was written in 1970, and it sort of lays out what he expects to happen over the next 25 years. And, you know, if you read it, he could have been a psychic because he laid it out so clearly as to what would happen both culturally, economically, and socially, both in the United States and globally. It's scary.
I would doubt that they could focus specifically an idea into somebody's head, but certainly making them generally compliant or placid certainly would seem to be within the realm of the current capability of the technology you're talking about they're working on now. Would that be accurate, do you think?
With HARP as it stands, yes. But let's talk about a technology that was developed as far back as 1958.
All right, let's do that right after the break. We've got 30 more minutes with Dr. Begich from Alaska. Angels Don't Play This HARP is the book he co-authored. Pretty strange stuff. Eclectic. But that's what we do. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995. Listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, tonight featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from December 1st, 1995.
Angels Don't Play This HARP, Advances in Tesla Technology, co-authored by Dr. Nick Begich, who is my guest, and we've got just blazing phone lines here, so we're going to try to concentrate this last half hour on those. Now, Doctor, we've got a lot of people on the line. So let's try in the last bit here to run through a bunch of calls. How about
that? That sounds great.
All right, then here we go. On the first-time caller line, you're on the air with Dr. Begich. Hi.
Hi.
Where are you?
I'm in Salt Lake City, Utah.
All right.
A quick question. In the future, if I call an 800 number, am I west or east?
You're west.
Okay. I remember about a year ago this last summer, in the summer of 94, rather.
Yes, sir.
We had a lot of people calling you over a couple-week period saying that they're just feeling generally uneasy.
Oh, yes. I do recall that. Yes.
That they were feeling. I remarked at the time because I had been having similar feelings. I went, gee, what is that? And there was never anything anybody could pin on that. Doctor, could this be related?
Okay, the HARP facility did not start operating. The first test was December 15th, 1994.
Ah, yes, but you said there were other...
Exactly. So there are other radio frequency transmitters. It would be more unbelievable to suspect that they didn't have smaller units in battlefield use at this particular juncture. And there's a lot of speculation that they utilized smaller systems for the Gulf War and some of these larger systems for other experimentation.
Battlefield HARP, so to speak, huh?
Right. And, you know, and what we did in the text is we touched on those things, but we really delineate between what speculation and what the facts are. And as we roll through the book, each place where there's a fact, we footnote it right at the bottom of the page so a person can go right to it and know where we drew it from.
All right.
And it's cleanly laid out so that those kinds of questions can get answered.
All right, good. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Where are you calling from, please?
Maui, Hawaii.
Maui, Hawaii, okay.
Yeah, my name is Tim. Doctor, I've got a couple questions for you. And of course, I don't know if you folks remember or not, but when the Daily Briefing Officer came out at the end of the air war, and when they were ready to start the ground war in the Middle East war, the Daily Briefing Officer stated that now we're going to turn on the PSYOPs. He caught himself very quickly, began to change his approach of what he was saying, and it, of course, was very mysterious that they all just surrendered after they were dug in and entrenched for a long time, but that's not
true.
My question.
It is a good point, though.
Yeah,
very good point.
And that can be documented, by the way. That is on tape. We're down here in Hawaii. I'm an electromagnetic engineer, and we've been keyed into this thing since about March or April. And I've read your, not your book, but I've read your article in the Tussler Extraordinary Science, and gotten some additional information. I've also read the Eastland patents completely, and I understand them, of course. And the thing is that we're hearing here, actually hearing, and I'd say it's 4 out of 10 people, are hearing a very high-frequency pitched sound. In my mind, I used to work in the studios, it sounds like it's about anywhere from 14 to 16K, meaning as far as kilohertz are concerned, an audible frequency. Excuse me. But the thing that we're finding is that when we take a regular audio spectrum analyzer, we're not able to at all identify this frequency in terms of any amplitude over normal bass ambient amplitude of all sounds heard.
Let me stop you and ask you, throughout the Hawaiian Islands on Maui, how widespread?
It's everywhere. We can even go down into deep gulches and ravines where there is absolutely no RF. And by the way, we have a 14 gigahertz spectrum analyzer. We're trying to get a 50 Ka band spectrum analyzer amp so that we can see if this is a much higher frequency. But we were able to take a automobile radar unit, which will detect Ka band, which is between 43 and 50-some gigahertz.
Right.
And we were able to find certain carrier waves, but they were coming off the top of the crater here. I think you're familiar with Maui, sir.
Right.
And, or I believe you're going to come here shortly. Anyway,
right,
the tests that we've done virtually everywhere, not only on this island but on other islands, with the spectrum analyzer and with other various detector devices, have literally evaded us as to the source of what we're hearing, and there are far too many people here who are in fact hearing it for it to be simply anomalous and in my hearing. I worked in studios in Los Angeles for years, and I keyed and tuned up my ears to hear very slight nuances of sound changes. And the bottom line here is that this is so loud at night when the actual ambient noise level or noise floor of the environment that I live in,
right.
And Maui is a very quiet place because we don't have a lot of traffic and things here, that sometimes I find myself literally waking in the middle of the night. I've also had myself, during the middle of the day, literally go into brain lock, literally where I have had no ability to understand who I was, where I was, and I was in my own house. I was going to the refrigerator, as it turned out, and it lasted for 10 seconds. And I shook it off, meaning I shook my head and I go, what in the world is going on here? But it was very strange. We also periodically, in surveying people, have found that people have had strange pains in their side of their head on the left side, a pain that periodically maybe only happens once a month, but the pressure and the pain of it is so great that you literally feel like you're going to drop to the floor.
All right. Well,
I'd just like to know, I think that in studying how they're projecting this pattern, this beam, many times I think they may be testing it out over the ocean, possibly, or on a grid line or flux line over the ocean, and I think that something is going on here on a full-time basis. They're also building a particle accelerator on top of the crater here.
All right, thank you. That's from Maui. That's quite a story.
If I can respond to that, I've heard rumor that there is a small RF transmitter being used on Maui. I'll be there sometime in early March to lecture. But when you talk about the impact on individuals, and because you're technically oriented, there's a patent that you should look up. It's number 3393279, and it was issued to Patrick Flanagan on July 16, 1968. And what it is it's for a device called a neurophone that was also written up in the September 14, 1962 copy of Life magazine. And the neurophone is a device that takes sound, digitizes that sound, and then inputs it through any nerve ending where it ends up in the brain. So it sounds like you're hearing something, but it's done with an electromagnetic digitized transmission. Right. And when he first invented this device, it was in the late 50s, and he applied for a patent, and it took him 7 years to finally get that patent. And what happened is the patent office denied it, said it'd never work. He took the device in, asked if there was a deaf employee or someone deaf on the staff that they could test this with. They had one, a deaf person, came in, they hooked him up to the neurophone. For the first time in 15 years, the guy could hear. They immediately opened the case file, granted him the patent. Subsequently, he then applied a month later for a second patent that he had developed working in a Navy project on dolphin speech through Tufts University that was an even finer sound quality. I mean, very fine sound quality. Immediately upon filing, the United States Navy seized it under a national security order for 6 years and locked it up. And that technology has been around a long time. And I was with Patrick 2 weeks ago and tried one of these Neurophones.
Yes.
And it works as advertised. You hook it up. I hooked it up to my thumbs, and there are two electrodes with capacitors. It took Joukowsky, ran the sound through the conditioner, which was the Neurophone, into the electrodes, and it was like when you imagine a piece of music in your head, forget concentrating on it and crank the volume up 10 notches, and that's what you get in a Neurophone. And he's mentioned, and this technology is mentioned in our book, as sort of an indicator of what has the U.S. government done since 1967 when they originally seized that patent. What have they done to develop that technology, and could they have developed it wireless? And we don't know the answer to that, but we do know the technology existed then. In fact, that technology and the other things that Patrick has developed over the years is the subject of a forthcoming book. It's our next project that's coming out sometime in the spring.
All right. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hi.
Hello, Art. Hello, Doctor. This is Dorothy in Liberal, Kansas.
Hi, Dorothy.
I have a similar story to your fellow in Maui. Two different things here. At least three times since last winter, a friend and myself had witnessed something like lines in the sky radiating from the ground up and then being intersected like a grid in the sky. At least three different times, last winter, in the spring, and then this past summer. At the one time that we noticed, it was just several days later, that the temperature shot up to about 90 degrees in January. Now, tomorrow it's going to be about 85 here. The other thing is people are getting ill here, and whatever this is, it's affecting the ears, total disorientation, and I do have a place over on my left side of my head that starts burning and stinging and hurts periodically. Don't know what it is.
You know, we've heard these reports out of Oregon. We've heard them out of New Mexico, now Kansas, and Maui as well. You know, I don't have an answer for it because the way I approach things is I try to stay, you know, quantitative. If I can show something that's really solid. What I can tell you is there were various campaigns on the HARP project that did run in December. They did run, you know, through the winter. There was additional campaigns in the spring and in the summer. So, you know, could it be? Maybe. But, you know, it is speculation. But I would suggest this, that, again, when you've got all of these things happening naturally in the environment, and then you have this addition of a small amount of energy, could these effects occur? The answer is absolutely yes.
All right,
the technology is there.
Hold on just a moment. We'll be right back to you. My guest is Dr. Nick Begich. All right, trying to squeeze in as much as we can here, Doctor. From Madison, Wisconsin, you're on the air with Dr. Nick Begich. Hi.
Thanks to you, Art, for getting this out on the air. It's like getting a lottery to get through.
Yeah.
Okay. You're getting so big. You're so successful. Anyway, listen, this is the state that experienced possibly the ELF project in a big way. The first time they turned it on, we had huge downburst winds, 60 miles an hour. We had thunderstorms. We had lightning and thunder, even in the winter. And, you know, I'm wondering what the correlation between Project ELF here and Project HARP there is. Are they really identical projects?
What you have here is
One other question, too. But go ahead.
Well, one at a time.
What you have here is a much more advanced technology. I mean, it's like comparing a UNIVAC computer filling up a warehouse to a pocket calculator in terms of concentrating the power. They've just gone so much further with the technologies that what they can do with this tool is it's much more controllable, much more versatile. It just has the capabilities, you know, are just incredible. And it's, you know, going back to what they originally built in Wisconsin, it was predominantly a communication device that did have a number of these side effects. But I don't believe at that point in the game that they were really looking so much for that as maybe just playing with it, trying to see where the perimeters were. But this, I believe, was deliberately designed to create all of these effects that over the last 30 and 40 years they've been building towards. The only thing they were lacking were these last few patents that gave them the capacity to focus that energy and deliver it to the ionosphere so they could create a global effect. And, you know, what this speaks to is a document that we found, and it was one of the last documents we found, which was put together by the United States military, and it's called The Revolution in Military Affairs and Conflict Short of War. And it was put out by the U.S. Army War College. And what it discusses is that in order to introduce these kinds of new technologies, it will require a revolution in the way people view things. And what specifically that means is that in order to introduce technologies that have these kinds of effects, they have to change the way the American people mm-hmm. look at the world. And what they specifically say in that document is that without changing the way Americans look at the world and look at their freedoms, these kinds of new technologies will be resisted. And so in this document that the government put together, it's a 36-page document, well-resourced. We provide it as one of our sort of resource materials to book buyers, and it's sort of referenced in the back. But it really lays out what their intention is, and their intention is to introduce these new weapons by first changing the way the public will view them, by creating an environment
where
we'll accept them.
All right, we're very short on time. You had a second part?
I work in the mental health industry, or I used to, and I'm wondering if a lot of crazy people aren't like the canaries in the mine in this situation, because I noticed when I was working in a group home for retarded adults that after they turned elf on, a lot of them just started acting stranger and stranger, and I always wondered if it had anything to do with that, I'm just wondering if there's a level of resistance that certain people have to this, and I'll get off. Thanks.
Yeah,
right, thank you.
Each person, you can look at each person as a transducer, something that changes energy from one form to another, and each of us is unique and different. So how we each individually handle energy is unique and different. It's like in Maui, 4 out of 10 people hear the thing and the other six don't. It's because their physiology is such, biochemically and electromagnetically, they're more sensitive in certain areas. Likewise, I think a lot of mental illness and what we were finding in a lot of it's so new. I mean, it's just leading edge. But what they're finding is that by manipulating brain frequencies deliberately and with understanding, they can change brain states and make unhealthy people healthy and vice versa.
So
there's a lot going on.
It cuts both ways. All right, maybe one more very quickly. West of the Rockies with Dr. Begich. Hello.
Yes. Rachel Art, can you hear me?
I can hear you. Where are you?
I'm calling from Phoenix, Arizona.
Phoenix, all right. Go ahead. Real quick.
Okay, previously on one of your shows, you had someone who talked about the tunnels and underground bases.
Yes.
And that they do exist, et cetera. And the closing down of some of the military bases didn't seem like it was something we should be doing at the time.
Right.
But if this is capable of creating a complete disorientation among us, number one, could it possibly be used to disorient a certain amount of the population here in America so that a certain echelon or special people are allowed to escape to the tunnels if there is a coming global catastrophe?
All right. Very quickly, Doctor, because we're about out of time.
Basically, you know, I don't know the earlier show, but can it disrupt my mental function, a large percentage of the population? The answer to that is yes.
All right. I want to tell you, it has been enlightening, to say the least, a little frightening, a little hopeful, but so I don't know how to feel about it. I guess it's going to go on whether we want it to or not. That's, I guess, the way I feel. I mean, we might write letters to congressmen or senators, but the bottom line is, I'll bet this sucker gets funded no matter what we do, Doctor. So we're going to come back to you at some point as you find out more, which you're doing, I know.
Yes, indeed.
With input, and I'm sure you want input from other people.
You bet. If people call that number and get our mailing address off of that message system, we sure would like to hear from you. If you have something out there that you believe we need to know about, we sure would like to have it, and we'll get it out to the American people.
Dr. Begich, it has been a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right, everybody. Thank you. It has been a pleasure. We'll be back with A Dreamland on Sunday. And then the regular syndicated program Monday night, Tuesday morning. Thank you all for a wonderful week of talk radio. And from the high desert, good night, America.